following video contains subject matter which may be emotionally sensitive to some viewers. I make no attempt to take the politically correct approach in presenting this material. The subject of abortion covers a broad spectrum. The area of rape is not addressed as it becomes a totally different study all its own. The disagreeing views for or against abortion are noted. What scripture constitutes as a marriage are also noted. The viewpoint of marriage is taken primarily from the position of the legal paper contract provided by man and not the biblical view of having sexual relations with someone. There are many facets that may not be addressed in this lesson but are in no means overlooked. The lesson is simply designed to point out a few facts about what scripture has to say and what people think, say, and do. As always, we all have free will and may agree or disagree on any or all points made. We all choose what we believe. Regardless of this, I'm sure some will be offended and feel the need to express it in some form or another. I just ask that you are respectful if you have an emotionally sensitive reply. Please don't assume that I have no understanding, sympathy, empathy, or even experience with the matters of rape, assault, abuse, abortion, etc. Abortion is very serious subject matter, and some go into it in a state of selfishness, fear, lack of knowledge, and understanding, to name a few things. This is my view based on what I believe, knowing what I know of scripture and the world from living in it.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I'll be having a blessed and peaceful Sabbath. Now, first of all, I'd like to say that I hope you listened to the disclaimer at the beginning of this video, and if not, let me touch on three points that I was trying to make very quickly. When it comes to the subject matter of rape and or sexual assault, I'm not going to address that in this video to justify or not whether it is right or wrong for a woman to have an abortion if she gets pregnant based on this type of situation. I don't find it necessary, and it's just a point to lead into a bunch of arguing and debating, so I'm not even going to go there. It's not necessary to get the point of what man thinks and what the Father's Word says across, so we can eliminate that, and those are basically my reasons why. Secondly, marriage. Marriage is defined according to Scripture as those we lay down with. Whoever you lay down with sexually, biblically, you're considered married to them. So plenty of us have been married many times over by virtue of having sexual relations with multiple partners. People need to understand that. And then finally and foremost, responding. I'm sure that someone, because they will get emotionally charged about this, may feel the urge to have to respond. All I ask is that you're respectful in doing so, because the word is the word. And I'm not pointing the finger at anyone directly. I'm pointing the finger at understanding and knowledge that people need to know and things people need to consider. So with that being said, I'm going to go right into this study. So first question, when your minor daughter who's unmarried comes to you and tells you that she's pregnant, what do you do? Second question, if that pregnant unmarried woman is you, what do you do? And don't be misled, ladies, and don't be deceived. Some of you will be in this position, are in this position, on one side of the fence and or the other. And if you're not, you may be there before it's said and done. So be on guard, especially if you have daughters today in this society, as to where they have become the aggressor and the young man get to pick and choose whom they will lay down with. So be on guard. Understand this. The world calls this premarital sex. It dresses up what it truly is. The father says it is fornication and it is a sin, cut and dry. He tells us what everything is at the root, and then we get to pick and choose what we want to do with it. 1 Thessalonians 4:3 reads, it says, "For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that ye should abstain from fornication, that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor. Not in a lust of concupiscence, which is a strong sexual desire, even as the Gentiles which knew not God." And Gentile back then was nothing more than a non-Jew. So you had Jews and Gentiles. Simply put, is all it's saying. So he's telling us that we, even in our sanctification, should abstain from sexual immorality because these are his vessels. Now remember, these are his vessels and his temples. And when we do these things, we're defiling something that's his. 1 Corinthians 6:18 says, "Flee fornication. every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. Think about what they're saying. Every sin that man doeth is without the body. But when we use these bodies to commit fornication, we're committing sin against these bodies, his bodies. So, now that we know what fornication is, and that pregnancy is usually a result from doing such a thing, the coded question always comes up, and this is what people say. This is the enemy's subtle version. They say, what are you going to do? How more coded can that be? The true question in its harsh reality is, are you going to keep the child or kill it? See, people like the enemy's version better because the accurate question will cause many to hesitate and think about what they're doing, and let alone it may hurt some feelings. But selfish desire combined with the wiles of the enemy won't allow people to ask a direct question by disguising the fact that it's killing of a child. That's what it is. See, his way of asking is subtle, it's gentle, it's non-threatening, it's been covered up as to what it really is. So to ask, are you going to get an abortion, is a little more aggressive. Some people may do that, but the just straight up question of asking, are you going to kill this child or keep it, is considered way over the top. So many people fall into the line of political correctness or so-called being sensitive by not asking the direct, harsh question. But that's what it is. What could be more inconsiderate than asking that direct question in all its true harshness? Now, in Exodus 20:13, Scripture says what? Thou shalt not kill. See, the willful and voluntary killing of someone is murder. See, we understand this and we can accept it when it comes to adults. But when it comes to a child in that harsh reality, people don't want to hear it, and people don't even want to allow themselves to be privy to hearing it. See, this is where the devil chimes in with this deception. He's convinced many in the world that conception doesn't even constitute a child. And man, through his laws, judgments, and even medical science, says that Satan is right by saying what? That you can abort a fetus or embryo up to 22, 23, 24, 28 weeks old. So we've all fallen victim into buying into what Satan has orchestrated. So a pregnant woman will come along and say, I would like to abort this embryo to terminate this pregnancy. But once again, the truer question should be, I would like to kill this child in me because I no longer want to be pregnant because my selfish desires right now don't have room for a child in them. See, that's what the harsh reality is, and that's what it sounds like. But no one wants to hear the truth. No one wants to hear it directly said to them. But that's it. So we dress up fornication by calling it premarital sex, and we call murder of a child abortion of something that's not even considered a child yet. See, abortion is defined as what? It's defined as a removal of an embryo or fetus to terminate or end a pregnancy, causing death to the embryo or fetus. So the question is an embryo or fetus a child? Well, an embryo or fetus is defined as an animal or human in the early stages of development, but has not reached a recognizable form. So here's a question. If you know what something is before you can recognize it, does it change the fact of what it is because it hasn't reached a recognizable form? If you know what it is what it is, whether you recognize it or not. And also, a fetus is defined as the offspring of a mammal, in particular an unborn human baby, more than 8 weeks after conception. So, if we know that you're pregnant with human life at conception, then why all the debate? Well, because at this point is when the deception begins, if the circumstances surrounding it aren't conducive to what a woman or girl desires in her life at the time. See, if she is single, unmarried, a minor, or just not ready for children, these things may or may not become a factor in deciding or dictating whether the deception becomes a player in painting the picture to justify her wanting to fulfill her own desires, and be it selfish desires, when you consider whether or not you're going to keep a child or not based on what you want. See, once again, I know it's harsh, but it's direct and to the point with no sugarcoating. So If you don't believe that an embryo or fetus or just even fertilized eggs is human life, consider this. If you claim to be a believer of the Heavenly Fathers, you can't claim Him and deny what He says at the same time. In Luke 1:35, Mary was told what? It reads, "And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." And then in Matthew 1:20, Joseph was told what? It says, "For that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost." So now the question is this. If Mary in 2014 decided that she wanted to have an abortion because she was pregnant, what would she be killing? Would she be killing the Son of God, or just a non-developed embryo, fetus, or some eggs that aren't developed into anything yet? See, many may say that something like this is different, or this situation is different, but at the end of the day, it is all life, and the Father considers all life precious because He orchestrates it in allowing it to happen. He uses men and women to set it in motion, but His power allows it and causes it, this creation, to happen. So in Jeremiah 1:5, the Father tells Jeremiah what? He says, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet unto all nations." So part of the point is, you cannot foresee what the Father has called your unborn child to be, even in your sin of creating it. But you can rest assured that the Father knows that child and what it will be even before he or she is formed. He says so in His Word. I just read it. See, Isaiah says in chapter 49, verses 1 and 5, that the Father called on him from the womb, the one who formed him, to be His servant. See, the truth of the matter is, abortion is purely an act of selfishness perpetrated by the devil and bought into by mankind through the deception that it's not life you're taking. See, he causes you to think about yourself and what you want in your life and how this pregnancy will hinder all that you desire. See, he causes you to think about the inconvenience this problem will cause, the burden of taking care of a child that you weren't even ready for. See, the enemy gets you so twisted in your thinking that you forget about the Father and all the promises that He's made to you and all the things He says are possible with Him. You forget about the Word and all that, and you become selfish in your mind and in your thinking and start thinking about what you want. See, you've forgotten the Lord and you've sided with the enemy. And he got you through that subtleness, through his trickery, through all the same ways that he got Eve. He did the same thing, and he's doing the same thing over and over to you women out here. And then next, on top of all that, you violate Exodus 20:13 because you have been led to trivialize life in your thinking. See, the life you've created and the life that the Father holds sacred. He says so in His Word. Acts 3:19 says, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the time of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." See, through His grace and mercy, there's still hope. There's always hope. Repent and turn away from your sin, not doing it over and over again. See, some women perform this sin over and over again. It's the sin of Exodus 20:13, "Thou shalt not kill." It doesn't matter that it's a child, it could be an adult. It's the same difference. In John 10:10, the Savior Himself tells us, "The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly." See, this is what we must understand. The Father's objectives and the enemy's objectives. And 1 Thessalonians 4:3 tells us, "For this is the will of God, even in your sanctification." Remember, abstain from fornication. Remember, like always, the Father cuts off sin at its root. If we abide by the Father and His Word, abortion becomes a non-factor. Abortion is killing. It's the killing of a child, and it's a counterfeit perpetrated and orchestrated by the enemy. Remember, everything that the Father has, the enemy creates a counterfeit. So abortion or killing of a child is a counterfeit to life that the Father says that He holds sacred. So When we fall, we must be willing to do what? We must be willing to suffer and or deal with the consequences of that. Galatians 6:7 says, "Be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, they shall also reap." So we need to be willing to reap what we sow and then learn how to lean on the Father to get us through and carry us through our issues. We can't fix issues by creating more issues. We can't get rid of a child and think that's gonna resolve issues. So many women suffer unnecessarily after they go through this type of act. Through all the deception that led them there, they felt and thought they were doing the right thing. The enemy is out to destroy you. Be willing to reap what you sow and go through your trials, because if you don't go through that trial, believe me, plenty more will be ahead of you once you go through this situation. And with that, like I always say now, check your feelings at the play button and move your toes out of the way if you don't want the computer to fall on them. This is a serious subject matter, people, but the truth is what it is, and the Father's word is what it is. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.